sight, believe the yard. But if you think so, we are gonna stand up and wait. No way while we hold the gate for you. Nothing so at all. But I'm an Anya. I'm an Banya. Canada, no visa, patapoya, belly full, ya, sweet Jamaica. But when you stop and check out the facts, is a cool heap of thing Jamaica love. A problem it never solve. No man won't be getting ball at all. We sit down and ball. But I'm an Anya. I'm an Banya. I'm a Livia. Pick up America. No visa. But a boy. Jamaica. Five flights a day to Miami. Don't mean a thing to this man. As long as man give labor on his work for money, there is not a man can move me from my land. When last you really check a yard, remember saltfish fritters fuller and pure, wash it down with a high school beer. A true, it no bad at all. But I'm an Anya, I'm an Banya. Jamaica, I'm an Anya, I'm an Banya, I'm a Livia, Vico America, no visa, but a boya, belly full, ya, sweet Jamaica.
Happy, sing it sad, old song seeker, show us what you found. Devils, angels, and in between, strutting, shuffling through their scene. That's the way the wheel goes round and round. Coming from far different places, colors of the rainbow faces, where only the red man once was found. From the east, south and west to a northern dream, underneath the blue Canadian sky. Steel band man, bazooki picker, Napoli accordion player, are you trying to keep your roots still strong? Madeira man and Madrid woman, Athens beauty and Glasgow he-man, as you dance, do you feel you belong? Quebecois, Anglo-Canadian, were you asked by some comedian if south of the border is your song. Dance the soul, rock and roll, don't ask who plays the tune. Underneath the blue Canadian sky. Neon lights, fast hamburgers, tall skyscrapers and rubdown parlors. Find your dream between them if you can. Newfoundland is filled with laughter. Alberta has the all thereafter. Take your pick of futures across the land. Toronto's clean and Quebec's pretty. Saskatoon's a friendly city. White horses where a man can be a man. See the green in between, soon it may be gone. Underneath the blue Canadian sky. Sarsi, Ojibwe, Haida, and the Plains Cree. You Canadians, their cry, do you hear? Blue bloods, true bloods, with your power, are you waiting for the hour when this country's first ones disappear? From across the sea we've all come, some for our own and some for freedom, spreading across this Greenland everywhere. As we led fast ahead, is gold our only dream? Underneath blue Canadian sky. Underneath blue Canadian sky. Underneath blue Canadian sky.
Wake the village and tell everybody, man, woman, and picnic. It's folk song time. It's time to wine. Hey.
Welcome to Caribbean Connections, your weekly dose of Caribbean vibes, featuring poetry, cricket commentary, special guests, and more. I'm your host, Sarojini, and stay tuned for an hour of great Caribbean programming.
Morning, neighbor, morning. Morning, neighbor, morning. Morning, neighbor, morning. I don't want your knife in morning. When you been a group, you not been tell me morning. Now because your money don't, your hustle for tell me manning. Why? Geo go girl, away you go. Lady Bon.
Good morning. Thank you for joining me. I am Sarojini and I am the host of Caribbean Connections. Welcome, welcome. Today we have a very special interviewee in the studio with us, Dr. Ross Connolly, lecturer in counseling from the Wellness and Counseling Center right here at Memorial University. In just a few minutes, we'll get the opportunity to listen to Dr. Connolly, especially during this time of year where, you know, tensions are running high with assignments, exams, term papers, projects, all due around the same time. But hey, don't go away. We have got the answer for you and the real home remedy. Stay tuned. We'll hear from Dr. Ross Connolly and the services and resources which are available here right at Memorial. So let's get this Happy Friday started, everybody. We'll bring you some good rhythms of the Caribbean. And we're going to start off with this awesome track by Ken Professor Fillmore, Pan in A Minor.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, I would like to do a special shout out to you listening in St. John's and around the island in Regina, Toronto, Calgary, Saskatoon, Vancouver, New York, Connecticut, Washington, D.C., Berlin, Germany, New Delhi, India, and Warnemünde, Germany. Thank you all for joining me. Welcome back. I'm the host, Sarojini, of Caribbean Connections. And today in the studio, we have here with us Dr. Ross Connolly, lecturer in counseling at the Wellness and Counseling Center, right here at Memorial University. So Dr. Connolly is a graduate of right here at MUN, Memorial University of Newfoundland. He was in the PhD program in clinical experimental psychology and is provisionally registered with the Newfoundland and Labrador Psychology Board. He's very passionate about improving the psychological well-being of others with a particular focus on substance use disorders, mood disorders, and ADHD, Expertise in administering and scoring psychometric assessments among vulnerable populations, strong research and writing skills, excellent interpersonal and communication skills, and proficient time management and organizational skills. Dr. Connolly has ample experience with planning clinical research, collecting data, conducting analysis, and publishing findings. Dr. Connolly, and I know you've given me permission to call you Ross, so I will. Welcome. How are you this morning?
Hello, very well. Thank you for having me on the show.
Thank you for taking time off your busy schedule. I really appreciate that.
Yeah, sure thing. No problem.
I want to start off with a bit about your background, and we can start, if you don't mind, and I know you also give me permission, we can, you know, get our audience in check on a personal level, and I'd like you to tell me a little bit about yourself, your family, and add a little bit to the bio that I just read. Go on.
Sure. Well, I guess I was born and raised in St. John's, went to high school, just PWC, just around the corner from here.
Right.
Did about a year and a half of my undergraduate degree here at Munn before going to Mount Allison University in Sackville, New Brunswick. Where there I did an undergraduate degree in, or a BA, I should say, in psychology. And after that I came back to St. John's. I was working with, as an applied behavioral analysis worker, basically working with autistic children. And after that, started working with a community, local community group called Choices for Youth.
Mm-hmm.
And worked for them in a couple different capacities as a counselor in the young men's shelter. Mm-hmm. I did that for a couple years. And then I also worked as a frontline addictions worker.
Okay.
Yeah.
So in the Choices for Youth, what in particular would you be doing? Or what did you do when you worked there?
Well, I guess in the young men's shelter, we had clients basically coming in off the street who, you know, had employment problems, they had no housing, family issues, a lot of substance use, mm-hmm. basically people on the street. So we provided housing for 9 young men, ages 16 to 29,
mm-hmm.
and basically trying to work with them to connect them with employment and stable housing.
Mm-hmm.
The other position I worked in was frontline addictions worker. So in that capacity, we had basically worked with clients. We could see like 100 a day, even people walking in for virtually anything at all. Our focus is working with people with substance use, which is pretty highly prevalent among that population.
Yeah, I was just going to say that age group you mentioned, is it 16 to 29?
16 to 29, yeah.
Did you find from your experience that there was more substance abuse in that age range, or there was really no difference?
Yeah,
older than 29?
I think a lot of the drug use that we saw, a lot of it is initiated at a young age.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, like, when you're kind of entrenched in, like, street culture, it's like drugs are around.
Yeah.
And people rely on drugs for coping. So if you don't have people as supports, or, you know, you're kind of, like, left on your own,
mm-hmm.
people kind of fall back on drugs as a comfort, essentially.
Yeah, and we all know whether we've taken drugs or not, that, mm-hmm. And I wouldn't advise you to do that. It's very hard to get off these mm-hmm. highly addictive drugs. So give me, you know, a few ideas or a few, what are the resources available there for these young men that you're trying to get together, put their lives together, get them back out there, get a job, get a home, and so on?
Right. Well, basically at Choices, when I was working there, we weren't doing so much the individual counseling aspect. We were kind of connecting them with services in the community, so connecting them with Eastern Health or the resources that they need to, you know, work on their addiction. But basically, we kind of did everything else, like getting them in supportive housing, getting them at a point where they had some stability in their lives,
mm-hmm.
getting them, you know, off the street or out of an environment which, you know, it was easy to use drugs and access drugs.
Exactly. And just to switch gears a little and not to marginalize what you're saying, but speaking of stress and getting people, their lives together, getting their mental health in check, this is exam time at
right.
Memorial, and of course the counseling center, I'm sure, have seen a lot of students coming in with a wide range of issues. Maybe just need a little bit of talking. Some may need more. So at the counseling center, what can you tell us about the purpose of the Wellness and Counseling Center?
Well, the Student Wellness and Counseling Center has a number of services. So basically, we have GPs, or like family physicians. We have a psychiatrist available that works with us. We have a number of registered psychologists and counselors, and also nurses and social workers. So we all basically collaborate to help out whatever it is the students present with. So they can come in with like health issues and see a doctor, then come in with if they're under some sort of psychological distress, and we'll work on getting them connected with a counselor or psychologist as quickly as possible to address their issues.
I can imagine it's probably a really big struggle, you know, not only this time of year, but overall. So the moods you're saying, for example, confusion, struggle, and severe stress, I mean, we all go through that, mm-hmm. you know, at different levels. So I would imagine students coming in, they've got the added pressure of I'm missing classes, I've got assignments due. So give us an idea like the process and the waiting times at the center.
So I guess we try to see people as quickly as possible. We have like walk-ins available for essentially, we call it like a single session, mm-hmm. though it doesn't necessarily have to be just one session. It can turn into more than that. But students can walk in and essentially see a counselor to address whatever issue it is, whether it's academic or if it's something more serious, like a mood disorder or something that can be addressed longer term.
Exactly. So, I mean, if the case is very severe, I mean, to put it bluntly, if someone is coming in very suicidal, as an example, how would you deal with that?
For people coming in with like severe cases, like they're suicidal, we can work with that client at the center, but we follow a step care model. So basically, mm-hmm. we provide the like sufficient care or the, you know, necessary care that the client needs. Mm-hmm. So if they come in, they don't need, we do a single session, they come in very distressed, maybe that's all they need. But at that point, we might decide that they need ongoing therapy, so we can connect them or refer them to a psychologist or a counselor for like weekly or bi-weekly care. Mm-hmm. We also have online resources. There's various things we can connect a student with because they might not need ongoing care. They mm-hmm. just might need something like a support or a tool that they can access in the moment when they're feeling stressed out or feeling overwhelmed.
Right. And what is the website or the link for this online resource you speak of?
Well, if they come to the counseling center, we can connect them with, there's an excellent resource that I've used with a number of clients. It's therapist assisted online is one mm-hmm. that I use quite frequently with my clients, and it's fairly successful. I'll sit down with the client and mm-hmm. we'll go through after identifying what issues they need to work on, choosing modules, and basically they're like online lessons, mm-hmm. Provides education about what the issue is, and also there's like work that you can do, like almost like assignments and homework mm-hmm. To work on that that's prescribed through that program.
Excellent. The step care you just mentioned, give us an idea what you mean by that, the step care program.
Right. So step care, like as I was saying, the student comes in and we offer a certain level of intensity of care that's necessary without kind of without giving more than is needed. Mm-hmm. So like I was saying, we can provide online resources if they don't need anything, say like ongoing therapy or individual therapy, or we can continue to see them over a period of time to address an issue with a therapist, or if there's something more severe, like you mentioned, like suicidality, mm-hmm. if that's something that is kind of beyond the scope of the care that we provide in the center, then we'll refer them to help through, say, like Eastern Health. various programs in the community.
Excellent. So it appears that no matter what you're coming in with, you've got the care there. You've got people available. You've got nurses, counselors, psychologists, someone there to help you. And this is what we're trying to do. Let students know you're not alone. So right now, if someone is coming in at this time, what would you recommend to them when they come into the center?
Is it like say for like academic stress? Like if they're So yeah, this time of year, a lot of people are really overwhelmed with final exams, assignments that are due, and I find what a lot of students are doing is they're spending so much time focusing on their academics that they kind of I guess fall out of balance with everything else going on in their life. So I guess there's like three main pillars that I kind of refer to with clients, and that's sleep, diet, and exercise. Mm. And that's kind of like the foundation of being healthy, essentially.
Absolutely.
Your physical, and it's not only your physical health, but also your mental health. Mm-hmm. So when people are studying and any one or all of those foundational pillars kind of fall out of balance, then that has a really negative impact on people's ability to study and people's ability to kind of, you know, get in the right mindset to go into an exam. So people become overwhelmed, they get really stressed out, it mm-hmm. builds up into anxiety. So yeah, working, you know, trying to maintain balance, so mm-hmm. ensuring that you're getting out and going to the gym, going out and going for a walk, make sure you're still eating healthy meals, mm-hmm. not skipping meals, and just ensuring that you have a good sleep schedule as well. You don't want to be pulling all-nighters because that's going to impact you for a long time.
Ross, we're going to take a short break, and we'll be right back with this very inspiring discussion. Thank you.
2nd, someone flees their home due to natural disasters. The Arctic ice that regulates our planet's weather is vanishing. That means floods, famine, and more are on the rise. But there's a simple solution, and you have the right to know. My name is Parvati. Please join me in creating a healthy future with MAPS, the Marine Arctic Peace Sanctuary. Get involved at parvati.org, P-A-R-V-A-T-I.org. It literally means the world.
Do you have a little spare time? Do you feel like you're missing something from your program? Are you looking to be more involved on campus or in your community? The Student Volunteer Bureau can help. For over 35 years, the SVB has been helping students find volunteer placements, get more involved on campus, and provided students with professional development opportunities. Making most of your time at Memorial begins at the SVB. For more information, drop by UC3011, email svb@mun.ca, or visit our website at www.mun.ca/volunteer. Come check us out and see how you can make a difference today.
Hey, this is Dean from Collective Soul, and you're listening to 93.5 CHMR.
Oh, I'm newly calibrated, all shiny and clean.
Welcome back. My name is Sarojini, and I'm the host of Caribbean Connections. Today, we have in the studio with us Dr. Ross Connolly. He is a lecturer in counseling at the Student Wellness Center right here at Memorial University. Welcome back, Ross. We just heard, Julie Black, I Traveled. And we're talking with Ross, and yes, he did give me permission to call him Ross. We're talking about the services available at the counseling center. And we want to give everyone the idea and also give them encouragement and hope that they're not alone, that if you're in a crisis or you just want to come in and see someone, there is someone there. If you don't want to call a friend or a family member, we understand that sometimes people want to keep things private. We would like everyone out there to know there is a place for you. And Ross, I learned that the counseling center was established in 1970, and I'm pretty sure that things would have changed a lot during these years. So what can you tell us about the center today that probably wasn't there in the 70s or even in the 80s?
Well, I think just the collaboration or the circle of care in terms of having all the physicians and the counseling staff all working within the same center. I know even a few years ago, the counseling center was upstairs on, I believe it was still on the fifth floor, mm-hmm. and the medical staff and everything was kind of separated. It was downstairs on the fourth. So I think having everything together definitely brings a lot of benefit, because when we're collaborating, and there is a lot of collaboration between the medical staff and the counseling staff in terms of looking after the best interests of clients. So I think that's been probably the biggest change or the biggest advancement, probably.
Oh, absolutely. And I've gone up to the center a few times for different reasons. And, you know, I like that idea myself, you know, and also, like you said, the collaboration. You're not, you know, going up and down floors, you know, you can leave your office, right?
Yeah,
and just
yeah.
go to the next one and talk with whomever you'd like. And you mentioned there's psychologists on staff, right?
Yes.
So tell us a little bit about this.
The psychologists on staff, there are, I think, four presently registered psychologists at the counseling center. And we are basically seeing new clients coming in, and we go through like an intake assessment. And then we decide from there, based on that, like who would be a good fit. So among the psychologists, we all have our own kind of specialties and interests and focus. And we also have the MED counseling interns. and two new positions that'll be starting up hopefully at the beginning of the next semester. They're wellness navigators. So their roles will, they're all basically, you know, providing counseling services. So after the registered psychs see the student for the intake, we kind of decide who could be a good fit. Sometimes they stay on our own caseload, or we refer them to another registered psych.
That's a cool name, Wellness Navigator,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
I like that. So you just said that they will provide services as well.
Yeah.
So how this position that's coming up soon,
yeah,
how is that different from what you have there currently with some of the counselors that are there currently?
Well, I guess the registered psychs not necessarily entirely focused on the counseling aspects of it, but we also do work in terms of assessments. And whereas the wellness navigators and the interns, their focus is on actual counseling, so individual counseling, and also there are some group therapy offered sometimes.
Mm-hmm. So your staff is getting bigger then, so you can,
yeah,
provide more services, right?
Yeah, we need to expand to kind of catch up with the, I guess, the increasing demands of the student population and the size of the university as well. So.
And speaking of demands, I mean, I've been in Newfoundland 12 years now, mm-hmm, and I can certainly see a big increase in the international community here.
Oh, yeah.
Mun.
Yeah.
So would you say that there's a difference between domestic students and international students coming to the center?
I think some of the stresses that they experience are probably different in terms of just the cultural differences. You know, coming to a new country obviously presents unique challenges, and the center, we do some work with the Internationalization Office, so we try to connect students with groups or groups and established clubs, I guess, who the student can relate to. So,
yes,
you know, trying to bring connections.
Absolutely. And you are right. I mean, not only do the international students have the cultural differences, but on top of that, they're away from home.
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe no family members here, no friends.
Yeah, there's a certain isolation, I think, that comes with it.
Right.
And a sense that they're kind of alone. So working with the Internationalization Office, we're able to kind of connect students and, you know, everyone has academic stress, but try to reduce all the other stresses and anxieties that they have, okay, too.
Social. And how do you see the international students, say, after a few sessions of counseling, do you see a lot of them getting a little bit more adjusted, or they're feeling a little more comfortable with all the stress they're going under?
Yeah, I think anytime anyone comes into the center and it's it's a kind of novel environment, this is something they're not used to, and
mm-hmm,
I think just over time becoming familiar with how the sessions work and,
mm-hmm,
and what counseling looks like, I think generally students usually become more relaxed in terms of coming to the center. But yeah, I think after a few sessions, we provide the students with some tools that they need to,
mm-hmm,
to cope with the anxiety or the stress they're experiencing, and definitely see benefits, yeah.
Yeah, and I mean, domestic students as well, like, they could be coming from far away, like, say, Stephenville,
mm-hmm,
or Gander, and they're away from home as well.
Yeah, yeah.
So they might be getting the same stress as the international students, even though they are domestic.
Yeah, absolutely. We have students from, well, all over the province, all over Canada, from,
mm-hmm,
all over the world. But, I mean, the problems that students from, say, like Bay Roberts, it's only 45 minutes away, but they're still away from their family and away from what they're used to, and their,
mm-hmm,
friends might not be in town. So some of the issues that we see with students from the province are very similar to the issues the international students as well.
And do you see students from all faculties?
Yeah, we'll see anyone who is a currently registered student. So in any faculty at all,
mm-hmm,
any age, it doesn't matter.
Yeah, and that's actually what I meant to say, not that you're restricted to a faculty,
but
like for, you know, our listeners out there, it doesn't matter what program you're in.
No.
There's so many people coming in from all walks, all,
mm-hmm,
faculties, all levels, you know, different years, whether they're first-year students, second, third, fourth. Am I right in saying that?
Yeah, absolutely. And grad students a lot. We see a lot of grad students. We're actually expanding or just kind of reaching out around the university in terms of having satellite sites. So we have our MED interns in the fall and winter semesters. I'm not sure about the summer. Excuse me. And they, in, say, like the business building, engineering, education building, at various sites around the university, we have places where students could be in the business building, and rather than coming over here to the counseling center and trying to arrange to get in to see someone, mm-hmm. they can just go to this office, and basically it's like a single session walk-in, or mm-hmm. it can be ongoing therapy. So we're kind of expanding to these smaller satellite sites just so students have greater access.
Oh, that's an excellent idea. And I think students would welcome that with open arms, definitely. Literally.
And in residence as well, there's an office in residence that anyone, any student who's living in residence can avail of those services as well. And there's usually two interns there every semester, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Ross, we'll take a short break to listen to Jimmy Cliff, Many Rivers to Cross. Don't go away, guys. We'll be right back. You're listening to Caribbean Connections. My name is Sarojini.
Salsa, merengue, bachata, cumbia, reggaeton, and underground tropical beats with DJ Chamba on Ritmo Latino. Saturdays 2 to 4, Saturdays 2 to 4 p.m. Exclusive to 93.5 CHMR FM. Exclusive to 93.5 CHMR FM.
Este ritmo latino.
All right, you beautiful people out there, here we are. Your cricket report for this week. After winning the West Indies Women's Super 50 tournament in Guyana last month, Barbados found themselves in the same position once again, needing a win against the host Guyana to win the West Indies Women's T20 Blaze Trophy.
And what a way to start an over. More slower through the air, with a little bit of flight.
Barbados once again easily won the battle, restricting Guyana to just 85 for 7 in their 20 overs. They then quickly overhauled the total in just 16 overs to win by 8 wickets, thanks to 43 not out from Deandra Dotton and claiming the title of Women's 20 Over Cricket Champions of the Caribbean. In the Indian Premier League, IPL, Antigua Zilzari Joseph, playing for the Mumbai Indians, routed Sunrisers Hyderabad with 6 wickets for 12 runs in 3.4 overs, the best bowling returns in a match in the history of the IPL.
Yeah, look at this for a catch.
Even more amazingly, the stellar performance by the 22-year-old West Indies fast bowler came in his debut match in the IPL. On his way to surpassing 1,000 runs for the Kolkata Knight Riders in the LPL, Jamaica's Andre Russell flayed the Royal Challengers Bangalore attack to score 48 not out off just 13 balls, including 7 sixes and a 4 to take his side to an improbably last over victory.
Inside the ring to cut off the single.
Russell's productive season continued in his next match against Chennai Super Kings, where he scored a more reserved 50 not out to take his session total thus far to 257 runs in 6 matches, scored at a league leading average of 128.5 and an astounding strike rate of 2.212.4.
The West Indies need a wicket. They'll get the single. Yuvraj comes into the strike. 10 off 5.
One love, one heart. Let's get together and feel all right.
One love, one station. CHMR 93.5.
Saying give thanks and praise to the Lord, and I will feel all right.
Listen to your heart. Check out the Friday Morning Markout every Friday morning at 8 a.m. on CHMR 93.5. FM.
I know there's something in the width of your smile. I get an emotion from the look in your eyes. Yeah.
Welcome back. I'm Sarojini, and I'm the host of Caribbean Connections. We're talking with Dr. Ross Connolly here from the Wellness and Counseling Center at MUN. He is a lecturer in counseling right here at Memorial. Ross, so I'm going to move into something green here. I love the Green Mindfulness Program at the center. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, the Green Mindfulness is a program where basically students can come and kind of plant or cultivate their own plant. It's basically different kinds of like spider plants and house plants that we have available, and students can come, go through the process of taking a clipping or planting a seed. And the idea is that they take that home and they, well, I guess they, you know, give it some love, and they, yeah, you know, they look after that, and it's kind of it's a positive experience for the students.
What are the reactions from students about this program?
A lot of students really seem to enjoy it. We've had students come back and talk about some of their failures and successes with it.
Yes.
But I mean, it's like if the plant dies, it's just like, well, let's try again. And I mean, a lot of students come back. We've even had students come back with plants for us to kind of to disseminate or give out to other students. So some,
yes,
some people kind of it's kind of inspiring for them, and they kind of take it and really run with it.
So where do you guys get the plants from? Are they donated? Does the university or the center have to purchase these?
We have an HKR intern at the center who kind of oversees or runs that project, and she has a really big green thumb. Basically, we have funding available to go out and get the soil and like the little pots and things that we need to propagate and grow the plants.
Mm-hmm.
And she kind of oversees that program. We have a little cart with all the plants and all the materials, and we go down into the third floor of the UC, and students can come by and grow their own plants.
So basically, it's, you know, whoever would like to, I guess, participate in the program.
Yeah,
you don't,
yeah,
give it to every student that you see, but if they have an interest and would like to do that,
absolutely,
right?
Absolutely, yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
it kind of gives them a little bit of a sense of purpose, I think, for some students. It's just like, you know, you're like growing and developing something and watching it kind of bloom and blossom.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And we also have the crisis 24-hour line,
yes,
right?
Yeah,
and
yeah,
mobile crisis unit.
Yeah.
You can tell us a little bit about these two services.
Well, they're community services that are available 24 hours a day, and
mm-hmm,
I mean, like, students can come to the counseling center. We're open between 9 and 5, but the reality is that mental health issues aren't confined to those regular business hours. So outside that time, or even during that time, students can reach out to those resources for assistance on the phone. And the mobile crisis unit is that's a team basically that will come to you and assess your situation and decide like where to go from there. Sometimes students need to go to, or not necessarily students, but whoever they're seeing, the client has to go to the hospital or for further assessment. Sometimes they can just deal with or help the client work through the issue there at the moment.
I heard a quote, I know, by Dr. Peter Cornish,
yes,
who is,
yeah,
the director of the Wellness and Counseling Center, or by someone else, and do forgive me for not remembering the name, but when Dr. Cornish and I spoke a year ago, we were talking about different quotes, and I wrote this one down, and it goes like this: don't think of it as being a mental illness, but rather an opportunity to talk about one's well-being.
Oh, yeah.
Elaborate a bit on this for our listeners.
I think that's important when people aren't feeling well or they feel like they're overcome with the stress to, don't look at the issues that they have as some sort of a weakness, or don't define themselves by those.
Mm-hmm.
It's important to come and talk and basically learn the skills that they need, the tools, or be given the tools that they need to work with that mental health issues. I don't know, I just think that's important. They label themselves, I guess, or they see themselves as weak, but it's important to kind of be able to come and talk about it.
Absolutely. I mean, again, I think when I heard this quote, you know, it's giving people hope that you know, don't be shy about it. Yeah, there's no stigma attached to it. I'm looking after my well-being, right? Mm-hmm, that's it.
Actually, you just touched on something important that I should mention is the confidentiality at the center. So when students come in to the center, there's basically no information leaves the center. Mm-hmm. And any conversation that's had there is basically only shared between people who work there within that circle of care. So, I mean, students can rest assured that, you know, whatever they come there with, whatever the issue is, isn't going to leave the confines of the center.
Absolutely. And you know what? It is important for students to know that. I mean, I'm sure they know that coming in, but it's always nice to hear it.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, Ross, I can't believe we've been here an hour and almost, and we have like 2 minutes, and I have a great track queued up that will tie everything in here. Okay. But what are your final remarks?
I guess, I think it's important for students to have balance, like I was saying, ensure that you're not kind of skipping out on your healthy meals and your sleep and your exercise. It's important to establish that to be healthy and have a positive impact on your mental health.
Absolutely, and I couldn't agree with you more. Dr. Connolly, I want to thank you so much for coming in today,
taking
time off your schedule and to share these experiences, give us all the advice and tips. I hope we see you again.
Yeah, sure, anytime, just let me know.
And like I said, I have a great track queued up, not only to give us hope and to tie in everything with what you've said and what we've discussed with today, but there is anniversary coming up here on April 15th, 1912. 1,500 lives were lost at sea. Yeah. One of the biggest unsinkable vessel, the Titanic. So right here off our coast, you know, it's so close to home, and I'm such a Titanic lover, I have to admit. And I couldn't resist, you know, I really want to remember the 1,500 lives, pay tribute to the families, the loved ones. And for all of you listeners out there, I want to thank you for tapping into today's program. Please stay well, stay healthy, be kind, and we're going to hear Jima London, Bridge Over Troubled Water. Thanks for joining me. Bye for now.
When you're weary,